Om. Om Namah Shri Yatirachaya Vivekananda Suraye Satchit Sukha Swarupaya Swamine Tapaharine Om. Om. Salutations to the King of Monks, the renouncer and controller of passions, the sage Vivekananda, blazing like the sun, who is of the nature of the joy of Satchit Ananda, existence, knowledge, and bliss, absolute itself. Salutations to that Swami, the spiritual preceptor who removed the miseries of worldly life and distress. Good afternoon, everyone. Yes, happy Independence Day. Welcome to Ramakrishna Monastery, this time in the afternoon. It's been a while. This is our post-pandemic first 4th of July program here at Ramakrishna Monastery. Jai Ma, yeah. We've been looking forward to it. It's been a while, yeah. I'm so happy and so excited to see you all here. We've been working hard, and I thank to all our volunteers. Without you, it would have been impossible. Really. So it's truly a beautiful opportunity to work together, monks, volunteers, devotees, friends, making all these preparations so that we can enjoy our 4th of July day. After all, it's nothing but an opportunity for celebration. And who doesn't love to celebrate? I do. As long as I'm alive. So it is our tradition at Ramakrishna Monastery. This is our main program, the main program of the year, to honor our teacher Swami Vivekananda, who passed away, who left his mortal court on the 4th of July, but in 1902. Well, you know, in this country, we all love superheroes. Whether they are from the Marvel Universe or the DC, and I actually didn't know what DC stands for or stood for, it's called Detective Comic series. And apparently, you know, there is a fight. I mean, who is greater? Who is a greater superhero? I'm not going to go there. All I can say is that these guys are called superheroes. So even though fictional, you know, and carrying extraordinary superpowers, they all stand for what? Righteousness. And perform heroic actions. They are brave, kind, and always ready to sacrifice themselves for the sake of others. They are indeed unselfish people. And if we could summarize spirituality in one single word, what would that be? Unselfishness. So I'd like to confess, I have my own superhero. You know who that is? Swamiji Vivekananda. Yes, I have a message to the West, as Buddha had a message to the East, he said. I don't know if all of you know, but Swami Vivekananda became the star of the first Parliament of Religions, held in Chicago on September 11th, 1893, at the World's Congress Auxiliary Building, which is now the Art Institute of Chicago. As many of you know, he began his address with the words, "Sisters and brothers of America." Sisters and brothers of America. Everybody stood up applauding for 2 minutes nonstop. From then on, he was known as the Cyclonic Monk. The fame and glory that he earned in Chicago was followed up with his mission to spread the message of Vedanta in the West. He professed the universality of religions, the truth, the spirituality and ethics, and the sameness of all religious realizations. I am proud to belong to a religion which has taught the world both tolerance and universal acceptance. We believe not only in universal toleration, but we accept all religions as true. As the different streams having their sources in different places all mingle their waters in the sea, so, O Lord, the different paths which men take through different tendencies, various though they appear, crooked or straight, all lead to Thee. This was described by his teacher, Sri Ramakrishna, as the essence of a spiritual realization in his dictum, Yato Mat Tato Pat. As many faith, so many paths. And then he quoted from the Bhagavad Gita, whosoever comes to me, through whatsoever form, I reach him. All men are struggling through paths which in the end lead to me. Bhagavad Gita, chapter 4, verse 11. Stressing that sectarianism, bigotry, and fanaticism has filled the world, the earth, with violence, and the time has come for us to understand that there is only one God. It's about time for us to understand that there is only one God, and all paths lead to Him. In whatsoever form one seeks me, says the Lord, I reach Him in that form, for all mankind are but following the path I lay down for them. Swami Vivekananda expounded the Vedanta philosophy which harmonizes all religious ideals and all forms of worship, which were different presentations of truth and different paths of its realizations, to its realizations, the perception of oneness, thus pointing out the principle of universality and acceptance, which again finds its source in the Vedantic experience of all the ancient sages of the Vedas. The Vedantic idea that a human being is not the body, but the spirit, the Atman, living within the body. Man is potentially, essentially divine, he said, the same God in all beings, and the goal is to manifest this divinity in everyday life. What is the goal? To manifest our inherent divinity. God lives within us and manifests himself as you. So let us God expand. Allow God to express through you. Swamiji presents the Vedantic idea of the soul being divine, children of immortal bliss. What a sweet, what a hopeful name. Allow me to call you, brethren, by that sweet name, heirs of immortal bliss. The Hindu refuses to call you sinners. Ye are the children of God, the sharers of immortal bliss, holy and perfect beings, ye divinities on earth, sinners. It is a sin to call man so. It is a standing libel on human nature. The Hindu religion does not consist in struggles and attempts to believe a certain doctrine or dogma, but in realizing, not in believing, but in being and becoming. Thus, the whole objects of their system is by constant struggle to become perfect, to become divine, constant struggle to become perfect, to become divine, to reach God and see God. And this reaching God, seeing God, becoming perfect, even as the Father in heaven is perfect, constitutes the religion of the Hindus. Therefore, the whole object was by constant struggle to become perfect, to become divine, to reach God and see God, even as the Father in heaven is perfect. That constitutes the religion of the Hindus, to let the divine manifest, to let the divine be real in our lives. Are we allowing that to happen? In our own ways, yes. Not completely. Swami Vivekananda encouraged all of us to have a God-centered life. That was his mission, to make us understand the oneness in everything, to make us understand. Did you know that Swami Vivekananda loved the United States? He did. He felt that America was the place, the people, and the opportunity for everything, the American dream. The American civilization is, in my opinion, a very great one. I find the American mind peculiarly susceptible to new ideas. Nothing is rejected because it is new. It is examined on its own merits. Addressing the people of India, he said, "America is where more than anywhere else the feeling of brotherhood has been developed. An American meets you for 5 minutes on board a train and you are his friend. And the next moment he invites you as a guest to his house and opens his whole home for you." He spoke particularly of American women, their kindness to me. It would take me years to tell. They are the life and soul of this country, he remarked, and said he could never repay his debt of gratitude to them. As much as he was all praise for America, he did not hesitate to express his honesty regarding certain customs of the American life. In a letter written to his friend, the Hale sisters, we find him saying, "Nowhere have I heard so much about love, life, and liberty as in this country. But nowhere is it less understood. No guns here, right? Here, God is either a terror or a healing power, vibration, and so forth. Lord, bless their souls." And these parrots talk day and night of love, love, and love. Hard to take, but hey. Instead of materializing the spirit, that is, dragging the spiritual to the material plane as these folks do, convert the matter into spirit. Catch a glimpse at least every day. Did you hear me? This is a piece of advice to his friends, the Hale sisters. Instead of materializing the spirit, that is, dragging the spiritual to the material plane, as these folks do, well, we don't know any better, convert the matter into spirit. Catch a glimpse at least every day of that world of infinite beauty and peace and purity, the spiritual, and try to live it in it day and night. Life is evanescent, a fleeting dream, youth and beauty fade. Say day and night, Thou art my father, my mother, my husband, my love, my Lord, my God. I want nothing but Thee, nothing but Thee. I want nothing but Thee. Thou in me, I in Thee, I am Thee, Thou art me. Wealth goes, beauty vanishes, life flies, powers fly, but the Lord abides forever. Love abides forever. If here is glory in keeping the machine in good trim, it is more glorious to withhold the soul from suffering with the body. That is the only demonstration of your being. No matter, but letting the matter alone. Stick to God. Who cares what comes to the body or to anything else? Through the terrors of evil, say, My God, my love. Through the pangs of death, say, My God, my love. Through all the evils under the sun, say, My God, my love. Thou art there. I see thee. Thou art with me. I feel thee. I am thine. Take me. I am not of the worlds, but thine. Leave not then me. Do not go for glass beads, leaving the mine of diamonds. This life is a great chance. What? Seekest thou the pleasures of the world? He is the fountain of all bliss. Seek for the highest, aim at the highest, and you shall reach the highest. It was a little intense, I understand, but here we can summarize his message. Not to the public, this was a letter written to his friends. In short, stick to God. Have a relationship with God. Learn who God is. He called him the one. He calls him the one by whose command the wind blows, the fire burns, the clouds rain, and death stalks upon earth. Again, bear with me another 2 minutes. In another letter to another friend, he said, You see, to put the Hindu ideas into English and then make out of dry philosophy an intricate mythology and queer, startling psychology, a religion which shall be easy, simple, popular, and at the same time meet the requirements of the highest minds, is a task only those can understand who have attempted it. Then dry, abstract Advaita must become living, poetic, in everyday life. Out of hopelessly intricate mythology must come concrete moral forms, and out of bewildering yogism must come the most scientific and practical psychology. And all these must be put in a form so that a child must and may grasp it. That is my life work. The Lord only knows how far shall I succeed. Did he succeed? Yeah. Well, we all start somewhere. He wants us to understand the need to have a relationship with God, the one without a second Brahman, who is manifesting in everything, everywhere, and within us. Expansion is life, and contraction is death. Let us expand by transforming our personalities, by transforming our lives. Swami Vivekananda sacrificed his life not for his own salvation. He became the leader of a worldwide organization whose sole interest is to produce monks who can continue spreading his teachings. I carry deep admiration for his life and work, for as he said, life is short, give it up to a great cause. With this, I am introducing the topic, Swami Vivekananda's vision for the West. And our main speaker, and I'm sorry, I apologize, Swami, I think I took a lot of time, is Swami Sarvadevananda, who is our president, the Swami in charge of the Vedanta Society of Southern California, and he will address to all of us today. Welcome, Maharaj. Oh, okay. You know what? I can see that we have our brother, Swami Medananda. Yes, this is his first 4th of July, and Maharaj is pointing to him. So I'm going to let Swami Medananda come and welcome you all and say a few words.
Boy, I'm not quite expecting that. Anyway, good to see everyone. Happy July 4th. Thank you. This is a very auspicious day. We can say a doubly auspicious day in our tradition. Auspicious why? Because this is, of course, our National Independence Day. At the same time, in our tradition, it's also our spiritual Independence Day. There's a wonderful story about the moments before Swami Vivekananda passed away. Left his body, we say, Shoritag Kurichilan, in 1902, July 4th. He's lying on his bed. And at the very moment of his death, he mystically contacted one of his brother disciples. Swami, does anyone know? Who? Exactly, well, the monk shouldn't answer. give the other guys a chance, yeah. All right, so no more monks answering my questions. Swami Ramakrishnanandaji, yeah. Shashi Maharaj. So Swamiji used to refer to him as Shashi. So the moment of his death, he communicated, they didn't have phones at the time, right? So mystically communicating with his brother disciple, who was in South India at the time. He said, my dear Shashi, my brother Shashi, I have spat out my body. My dear Shashi, I have spat out my body. That's spiritual independence. So let's reflect on both the fact that today is auspicious because it's our National Independence Day, but also, more importantly, more fundamentally, because it's our spiritual Independence Day. And as Swami Dhyana Yogananda mentioned, the theme for today, Swami Vivekananda's vision for the West. And I thought it would be useful to reflect very briefly on one question. Why is it that Swami Vivekananda's message of Vedanta was so powerful and so well received in the West in the late 19th century? And I think that it has a lot to do, of course, with the fact that he was God himself coming and, you know, spreading the divine word. But why was the soil so fertile here in the US at that time? I think that it had a lot to do with the religious landscape at the time. Because religion then was usually associated with Christian fundamentalism. And Christian fundamentalists throughout the country were teaching doctrines like, for instance, original sin. We're born into sin. And Swami Vivekananda comes along and has the gumption to tell them, each soul is potentially divine. Every one of us is innately divine. It's a standing libel upon human nature to call a human being a sinner. How dare you call yourself a sinner? Second, Christian fundamentalists used to terrify people with the doctrine of eternal hell. If you don't join my church, you're going straight to hell. Don't pass go, don't collect $200. And it's internal too, it's not even a temporary hell. In Hinduism, at least we have temporary hell, but you get out eventually. No, for an eternity. If any of you have read Dante's Inferno, it's absolutely terrifying, the kind of tortures that you undergo in this eternal hell. Swami Vivekananda comes along and says, every single one of you without exception will attain liberation, will attain salvation, without any exceptions. The next question is, well, what about horrible sinners and all these terrible people that are doing terrible things? Will they also get saved? He says, yes. Probably not in this life, but eventually. So he also brings in the twin doctrines of karma and rebirth. Right? We reap what we sow. And this entire life, and not just this life, but this spiritual journey is a journey of many, many lifetimes. We've lived many times in the past. We will live again until we attain liberation. We're going to keep coming back until we get it right. It's a message of profound hope. Thirdly, Christian fundamentalists usually taught blind faith. Just accept, swallow what we say. Don't question, don't reason. Swami Vivekananda comes along and says, religion itself is no less a science than mathematics or physics or chemistry. You'll find if you run a keyword search on the complete works, the phrase science of religion comes up at least 30 times. I think 29 times maybe, to be exact. I have the exact number in my book. 29 to 30 times. Science of religion. He says, what makes a science? Every science is based on empirical verification. He says, religion is just as much a science in that sense. Why? Because we shouldn't just swallow what religions tell us. We have to verify the claims of religion for ourselves by directly experiencing, by directly verifying what the religion tells us. So the goal of religion is to realize God, is what he said at the end of the day. And again, this was very startling to this primarily Christian audience who just thought that, well, believing is enough. No. Start with belief and end with realization, with direct experiential verification of the truths of religion. And finally, whereas Christian fundamentalists were saying, my way or the highway, my way is the only way, Christ is the only way, Swami Vivekananda comes along and says, all paths are equally effective paths to the same goal of salvation. And he explained it in a very sophisticated way, in a very philosophical way. He said that every human being has different facets to that person's character. We have an emotional side of our nature. We have a dynamic, a volitional side. We have an intellectual side. We have a faculty of concentration. For each one of these dimensions of the human personality, there is a spiritual path. For people who love doing things, acting, there's karma yoga, the yoga of selfless action. For people who are very emotional and naturally devotional, there's the path of bhakti, bhakti yoga. For people who are intellectually inclined, there's jnana yoga, the path of knowledge. And for people who love to meditate, mindfulness and, you know, Patanjali's yoga meditation, there's the path of Raja Yoga. And he said, through any one of these yogas, you can attain the same goal. But to make your character most sort of balanced, most many-sided, the best thing to do is to combine these four yogas to the best of your ability. That's why many of you have seen, I think, that the Ramakrishna Mission logo, It represents the combination of the four yogas. That's the ideal for every monk in our order, but it's also the ideal of every follower of in this Ramakrishna Vedanta tradition, Ramakrishna Vivekananda Vedanta tradition. Not just monks, but everybody who follows our tradition of Vedanta should strive to try to combine to the best of your ability all four of these yogas. And then he makes a very radical move, and he says that each one of the world religions corresponds to one or more of these four yogas. And since each of these yogas can take us to the highest goal, that means any of the world religions is equally equipped to take us to the same goal of salvation, God realization, liberation. So on this very auspicious day, let's reflect a bit on Swami Vivekananda's message of Vedanta, this sublime message that is so powerfully relevant even today. And even more importantly, let's try to live our lives in accordance with his wonderful teachings so that each one of us, at the moment of our death, can say in triumph and not in depression, not having any regrets, not weeping and wailing, but in a moment of triumph, say, I have spat out my body. Thank you. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Overwhelmed with the two wonderful talks, invigorating in us the spirit of the divinity and freedom. As already have been said that we are celebrating today, the 4th of July, and it's talking about freedom. And Swami Vivekananda says, freedom is the song of the soul. What we are seeking for, nothing but freedom. Freedom from physical bondage, emotional, intellectual, and also so-called spiritual bondage. We find, we remember the story that Sri Ramakrishna one day was sitting in mood of meditation and his mind soared up. And he said, transcending the earthly plane, went to the mystic world and to the world of the gods and goddesses, and then entered into a realm where even gods and goddesses are not so pure to enter there. And that is a realm, and there, of the absolute non-dual, almost non-dual state, he saw seven sages called Sapta Rishis. And out of that, one of the sages, is Ramakrishna, took the shape of a small boy. And out of love, he embraced the neck of the sage, one of the sages, and says, I am going, you also come. And the yogi was steeped in samadhi, silently opened his eyes and gave a smile of consent. And when that light was born from Benares to Calcutta, Sri Ramakrishna could understand that same sage yogi has appeared in the world. This is Sri Ramakrishna's vision. The message of Vivekananda starts here. The state of absolute non-dualism, but there is no duality, no space of any gods and goddesses, angels or others. What's the question of demons and hells? There's nothing but absolute truth of absolute Satchidananda state. And one is steeped in that deep samadhi there, being called down by God himself to bring the message of that absolute joy into the life of we human beings who are strolling in the ground of the earth with suffering and miseries and pleasure and pain and indoctrination. That's why we find that Swami Vivekananda, when he first met, then what he said? Seeing first and listening to him, and he pulled him aside and said with a folded palm, I know you are the Rishi. I know that you are Nara Rishi, Narayana. You are the Lord Narayana. You have been born for the good of humanity. And then Naren thought, that young boy, what crazy person is this? I am most arrogant boy in Calcutta, and people don't like me because of my straightforwardness. And he is talking, he is the god Narayana. They say, ideally he is crazy. People talk about him, he is crazy. But that Ramakrishna didn't make a mistake. And that Nararishi Narayan, Narayana for the Narana Mayana. The Ayana means the end, the journey ends there. And the Nara, all the human destination, that is the Narayana. And he is the embodiment of that Narayana, Nara Rishi. And we find that with the touch of Sri Ramakrishna, he had his mystic visions and all struggles for God realization. And at the end, Naren Ramakrishna entered into the body of Naren. One day, Sri Ramakrishna was crawling and Naren was sitting. And he said, lo, 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 that man is entering into me. And Ramakrishna in his rustic Bengali language said, Sala, ki chiring biding kochis, what are you talking on this English. No? I am entering into you. The spiritual power. That tremendous spiritual power which has been regenerated in the life of Sri Ramakrishna, God Himself. Forget that. Even apart from that, practicing all the spiritual discipline, being an embodiment of spirituality in all possible path, he entered, that means this whole spiritual sadhana, whole spiritual practice entered into in the Naren. And at the point of death, what? Ramakrishna gave a written verdict. Naren will teach. He has not given that verdict to so many disciples of his. Not that I am trying to understand who is senior or superior or inferior. That's not the point. But Sri Ramakrishna selected Naren to spread the message of what he has given unto him to the whole world. Naren sikhe dibe. Naren will teach. When ghare baire hak dibe. When he will shout or loudly preach the message in home and outside the home. Then we find that how he is driven by the unforeseen power in his life. Ramakrishna passed away. Again, Naren stepped into the deep spiritual practice, went to the length and breadth of India to see the spiritual India behind the dark clouds of oppression and suppression and poverty and famine-stricken situations. He found the spiritual India which can flood the whole world with a new message of freedom and freedom and joy. So that is the way we find that he is directing him to come to this country. On the rock, Vivekananda rock, he found that someone is beckoning him, come, come, come. So this is the all orchestrated by the divine. And in him there is nothing but divine. So his message to the India or abroad is the same. Total freedom. But the channel is different through India, because India was poor and suffering from material needs and necessities. And where West, during Swamiji's time, is not to have think about food and drink and normal life. The message, same spiritual message, the awakening of the Vishwa Kundalini, the cosmic Kundalini power, Sri Ramakrishna came, and Vivekananda became his mouthpiece, through whom only Ramakrishna flow. And what is Ramakrishna? Nothing but experience, nothing but knowledge, nothing but joy, nothing but peace and salvation for the whole world. And that message worked here in one way. That is the message, as we have just heard, the fundamental message of freedom, the fundamental concept of sin. That sin idea, what just now we have heard, that sin idea, even now I see many of the devotees come to us and they said, what will happen to me? I am a sinner and is my salvation? I am a Vedanta now. I am not a Christian. What will happen to me? I will go to hell. This fear, this sin idea, is still haunting in our heart. Vivekananda came to uproot that. Ye sinners, that's just you heard that quotation. Ye sinners, it is sin to call a man sinner. It's to tell someone sinner. Then what is this? We don't see bad things in the world. Is Swami Vivekananda ignoring that side? No. Swami Vivekananda's language is scientific, as you've just heard. It is said that we do not travel from error to truth. Now, we mistake or sin to something, but we move from lower truth to higher truth to higher truth and higher truth. What a positive attitude. This whole West was crying and weeping, being embedded into the condition of this suffering from this meanness, or thinking that I am nobody, I am nothing, I am a sinner. I am a fallen person. I have no home. I will have to only go confess and do the same thing and give money another $100. to the confession room. Again come back and feel that I am same sinner. But this Swami Vivekananda redeemed all of the people in this world to think that you are divine. You have done mistake, be proud of your mistake. Have you heard any spiritual teacher say that you done mistake, do more? He said, I have done some mistakes maybe. He has not done anything, but what he said? But I am proud of my mistakes. Be proud that you have done something wrong. Be proud that you have done something to learn and not do again. But that has brought you to what you are now. What a positive message. That is the thing what West needed. West has money. When Swamiji came, women were very highly cultured. And the praise you have heard from the Swami Dhyana Yogananda's speech, that how he adored the women of this country. But the question is that is he saw the fertile land, and through his message is best expressed in the Nivedita's words in the introduction of Complete Works. You all know, I will read those lines. Now what he said, our whole life is spiritual practice. Our whole life, there is no secular and sacred. We make this distinction. Vivekananda came to break down this division, secular and spiritual. There is no secular. Everything is spiritual. And that is a grand message for the whole West. And that is to be followed every day. Swami Vivekananda's Complete Works, when it was written, Sister Nivedita, they wrote that introduction. And that's a oft-quoted, very powerful statement what he has given. Nivedita wrote there, if the many and the one be indeed the same reality, then it is not all modes of worship alone, but equally all modes of work, all modes of struggle, all modes of creation, which are path of realization. It's a beautiful message. It is the key message of Swami Vivekananda. It's not practical. It is a practical Vedanta. It is not talking about God and believe and do something and God, it will happen after death, go to heaven. Heaven concept is a very immature concept according to Vedanta. Heaven is in another place we are seeking for, where there will be more pleasure. How will be in the more pleasure and you'll be eternally happy? More pleasure will make you, what? More you want, even if you get, then you'll be tired of more happiness. Every day, take ice cream. And morning ice cream, noontime ice cream, afternoon ice cream, night ice cream. Every day, go to heaven and get everything free of cost. How long you will enjoy that? So we are given a wrong concept of life. That's heaven, 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 heaven. We don't want heaven. We want freedom. We should have the freedom to enjoy. And see, Ramakrishna experienced that oneness. Swami Vivekananda, one day, that stood under the Mayavati area, Almora area, he was meditating under the tree. And he said, a great mystery is revealed to me today. What a great mystery of spiritual life. What is that? That transcendental reality and the immanent reality, the same. That which is beyond and that which you see here, it is only one reality. You read the inspired talks we are reading nowadays, there you find that he's saying you are seeing God everywhere. You are not recognizing that. So what Nivedita wrote, if many, this many, and the one, absolute one, be indeed the same reality. That is the experience. What Nivedita learned staying with Swami Vivekananda constantly. That it is the one reality, and then what happens? In every mode of our action, in our worship, in the flower, with the flower and sandal paste, we did it in the temple. It is not limited there. In not all modes of worship alone are spiritual, but equally all modes of work, all modes of struggle. Every day we are struggling. Struggling to fight our disease, struggling to get out of our poverty, trying to get out of our unhealthy environment. We are trying every day. Life is struggle. No one needs to tell that. But every struggle, we think it is a wastage of life. But take it in perfect state, what Swami Vivekananda gave the message, it is your spiritual practice. Today's struggle, today's every action is an offering to God. You are interacting with God. You are living with God. We are seeing God. We are feeling God. You are touching God. Don't remember that. Don't recollect that. So this is the awakening, great awakening, what actually is the grace of Swami Vivekananda. So therefore, no distinction henceforth between the sacred and secular. That is the contribution of Vivekananda. No distinction between sacred and secular. He said in one place, I'm born to break all this distinction between all holy, unholy and everything. It is all divine. To labor is to pray. To conquer is to renounce. What a beautiful word. Conquering, we think I dominate over you. Conquering means I give freedom to you. And I am free. Renounce, give up. Give up what? Give up this mental clinging. Give up this meanness of mind that you are separate and you are separate. Ramakrishna Vivekananda stands for the philosophy of oneness and oneness alone. And that to have and to hold is a stern trust as to quit and to avoid. So learning this is the Swami Vivekananda's idea. And it is a great inspiration. Please read the books. Any page you turn in Vivekananda, what will happen? It will bring us energy. If you are sleeping, one Swami said that if someone is sleeping or he is going to die, you bring the words of Swami Vivekananda. He said, hey, death, wait. Let me hear what this guy is talking. Who is sleeping, he will sit up. Who is sitting, he will start walking. Who is walking, he will run. That is the spiritual energy, because it is the most unselfish gift, not only to the West, but to the whole world. So let his blessings flow through us, as we have, both the Swamis have invoked that idea, and let us be a fit instrument in the hands of the Master, Swami Vivekananda. Non-doctrinal, non-sectarian, not believing in the rituals and forms, temples and churches, breaking all this barrier, be spiritual, be that power house which is seeing the oneness and that one with the universe, one with divine and one with our own divine self. This triangle will merge into one. That is absolute oneness. That is God. That is Brahman. That is Atman. Thank you all.
All right, this song is called Holy Mother, and I'd like to say Swamiji is also my hero, and he also is deeply devoted to Holy Mother. So, Jai Swamiji.
Which way to turn? myself again. Holy Mother, hear my prayer. Somehow I know you're still there. Help me, please, find some peace of mind. Take away this pain. I can't wait, I can't wait, I can't wait any longer. I can't wait, I can't wait, can't wait for you. Holy Mother, hear my cry. I've called your name a thousand times. I felt the anger running through my soul. A hand to hold. Oh, I feel that the end has come. No longer my legs will run. You know I would rather be in yours, safe within.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. They slither while they pass, slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my open mind, possessing and caressing me. Jai Guru Dei. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Images of broken light which dance before me like a million eyes. They call me on and on. Across the universe, thoughts meander life. A restless wind inside a letterbox. They tumble blindly as they make their way across the universe. Jai Guru Deva. Nothing's gonna change my. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Sounds of laughter, shades of life are ringing through my opened ears, inciting and inviting me. Limitless, undying love which shines around me like a million suns and calls me on and on across the universe. Jai Guru Deva. Nothing's gonna change my. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think we have a last one. Oh yeah, absolutely. We have some more music coming up, so I'm gonna take off. I would love to just read my favorite quote by Swamiji, if that's okay, real quick. It is the God within your own self that is propelling you to seek for him, to realize him. After long searches here and there, in temples and in churches, in earths and in heavens, at last you come back, completing the circle from where you started, to your own soul, and find that he for whom you have been seeking all over the world, for whom you have been weeping and praying in churches and temples, on whom you were looking as the mystery of all mysteries, shrouded in the clouds, is nearest of the near, is your own self, the reality of your life, body, and soul. That is your own nature. Assert it, manifest it, not to become pure. You are pure already. You are not to be perfect. You are that already. Nature is like that screen which is hiding the reality beyond. Every good thought that you think or act upon is simply tearing the veil, as it were, and the purity, the infinity, the God behind manifests itself more and more. Thank you. Jai Swamiji.
Poetry can be so inspiring after listening to dry philosophy, but after listening to music, it can be pretty dry. Still, there was a very amusing incident to us, to me, a very touching incident. In 1898, Swami Vivekananda was traveling in Kashmir, the mountain realm of the very northern, northwesternmost part of India. And he was with one British and two American disciples. Sister Nivedita was British, but she was Irish, of course. And two, Josephine MacLeod and Sarah Bull. And on the 3rd of July, suddenly it occurred to Sister Nivedita that, hey, we should do something for our American sisters to celebrate the day, 4th of July coming tomorrow. What should we do? Well, they hired a tailor to sew an American flag. And so on the morning of the 4th, they surprised the Americans in the party with bunting and this rather crudely fashioned American flag, as Sister Nivedita relates. And Swami Vivekananda himself postponed a journey to be there for this little celebration, and he himself wrote a poem, this poem called To the 4th of July. And I will read it. It's a really rich and deep poem, which starts out as if it's to the American independence and political freedom, but then actually we realize that he's talking about spiritual freedom and the quest for freedom that we are all on, and how that quest gets fulfilled in freedom. And he likens the sun to the divine Lord who is bringing freedom to all beings on the earth. So this is the poem, To the 4th of July. Behold, the dark clouds melt away that gathered thick at night and hung so like a gloomy pall above the earth. Before thy magic touch, the world awakes. The birds in chorus sing. The flowers raise their star-like crowns, dew set, and wave thee welcome fair. The lakes are opening wide in love their 100,000 lotus eyes to welcome thee with all their depth. All hail to thee, thou Lord of light. A welcome new to thee today, O sun, today, thou sheddest liberty. Bethink thee how the world did wait and search for thee through time and clime. Some gave up home and love of friends and went in quest of thee, self-banished through dreary oceans, through primeval forests, each step a struggle for their life or death. Then came the day when work bore fruit and worship, love, and sacrifice fulfilled, accepted, and complete. Then thou, propitious, rose to shed the light of freedom on mankind. Move on, O Lord, in thy resistless path, till thy high noon o'erspreads the world, till every land reflects thy light, till men and women with uplifted head behold their shackles broken and know in springing joy their life renewed.
Once when Swami Krishnananda was asked to give a speech, he quoted the Upanishads, "His name is silence." And I'm very tempted to echo and follow in his regard. Sri Ramakrishna stressed, we were often taught that he in effect went back to the Upanishadic ideal, and he stressed that God has become all this. And we see this stressed very much in Swami Vivekananda's ideal of karma yoga. My brothers have said how Swamiji established an order for monks and encouraged the ones for nuns too. but his ideal of karma yoga, in a sense, echoes back to the Vedic ideal, where it wasn't temples, it wasn't sacred places. Every home was a sacred place. And Swamiji has given us a message and a mission for every person. We hope that people come to the ashram and the torch is lit, but it is our householder devotees who take this message into the wider world. You're the ones bringing up the next generation. You're the ones that are working these ideals in the workplace. So you have a very important part in Swamiji's message and Swamiji's ideal. Nobody is going to judge the whole of Christianity by the grumpy fundamentalist that works in your office. But you may be the only Hindu, the only Ramakrishna Vedantist that people ever see or ever meet. So you have a very special responsibility to embody that ideal, the ideal of service, the ideal of compassion, the ideal of non-judgmentalness. Those of you who are bringing up the next generation, you have a particular responsibility. The difficulty of establishing standards when everybody else can do it, why can't we? Is a special responsibility for you to embody these ideals in your home, to make your homes these spiritual centers that help elevate our whole society in the workplace and in the home. So this is Swami Vivekananda's very special message to those of you who aren't necessarily monks or nuns, but you have the responsibility to take the ideals of Swamiji into the family, into the workplace, and by doing so, help Swamiji's ideal of elevating the whole of society.
Shambho Swayambho, Bho Shambho, Shiva 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 Shambho Swayambho, Ganga Darashan.
Dimika, dimika, dimi, dimi, kita, kita, tom, 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 tari, kita, tari, kita. About a week, and like I said, he picked out all of the notes to the melody himself. He's kind of all right. 12. So, in honor of Swamiji, we of course have picked out all Shiva songs for today.
Shiva.
So sing along with this one. This is the one you've probably seen at Baylor Mott that they do on Shivratri. They sing over and over the Dimika, Dimika, Dimi, Dimika, Dimika, Dimi, Nache Bolona.
Bolo na, Shiva, Shiva, Shiva.